Okay guys, in the brief overview in this particular video, we'll be talking about the next generation sequencing. And one of the type, one example of the next generation sequencing, that is the ion torrent personal genome machine and 454. Both of the they are the genome sequencing machines, and they used to sequence genomes. So let's talk about those genome sequencing machines here. So let me take a color first. Let's take another. Okay, so here what we know is that though it's a shotgun sequencing, that means you can sequence a huge amount of genome using this method. So because, for example, human genome contains billion of nucleotides together, so you can first is the method of shotgun. That means it's a long genome and we need to break that genome apart into smaller fragments. So we just use physical shearing method to break it down. So now it's broken down into smaller fragments, which are blue in color here. So once we have this fragments in our hand, the small fragments in our hand, then the second task is the sequencing of each of these fragments, and then we'll analyze those sequence for the overlapping regions, and then we get the ultimate sequence of the human genome. So let's take one simple part of this nucleotide. So this is one of those fragmented DNA that we have. So we have this fragmented DNA. So after we getting this fragmented DNA, we need to add some adapter molecules in both the terminal. So this is the genomic fragment. We add two adapters in both the terminals. Now these adapters are made by us. So these are synthetic adapters, and we know the sequence of this adapter. And not only adapter, but we also add some barcode. So what is called as barcode. So let's say here we go, we add a barcode. Now what do we mean by a barcode? Barcode can be a fluorescently tagged molecule, or it can be something with a radioisotope, so that we can actually understand the presence of the genome during the process of sequencing. It's very important for marking the genome with something with which we can actually analyze that. And in this case, usually we use a fluorescently tagged dye. Okay, fluorescent dye. So once you prepare that, many of these fragments, I mean all the fragments are processed in the same way. So we have all those DNA in blue color, then adapters with the barcodes in one particular terminal attached. So once we have that, then we add that thing in, which is called a bead. So we have a bead. In the bead, beads are prepared by, again, synthetically in the chemical lab. Now in the beads, we have certain adapter sequences, or oligos, we can say them. So these are oligos which are also synthesized, or these are also synthetic oligos, and we know the structure of this oligo. And the structure of this oligo is complementary with the adapter that we added in both the terminal of our gene to be sequenced. Remember, in the previous slide, we have seen those green colored adapters, both the terminal, the sequence for that, and this adapters that is present on bead are complementary, so that those DNA can bind with these adapter sequences. So then what we have beads, and we added all our, so these beads are actually placed in wells in micro slides. So very tiny slides, very tiny holes in those pores. We have added those beads. Those beads are fixed there. Then we add our genes, DNA to be sequenced in each different wells. So we put that, and actually we not a single person need to do that, because we require robotics here to do that for you, because it's very tiny well. People can see it actually with our eyes very well. So we need to use robotics there, so it's kind of automated here. So they will add all these different fragments to be sequenced into the bead containing wells, and after adding them, what will happen then? Now it will cause the reaction called PCR, remember, to amplify, because until and unless we amplify our gene sequence, we cannot get hold on to it, because this is the basic of any DNA sequencing process, is to amplify the segment of DNA we need to sequence. Otherwise, in any kind of genetic analysis process, you need to amplify the target DNA, because target DNA is very low. You cannot get it more and more from the target itself, so you need to amplify it. So the amplification will go on here in each different tubes using PCR. So we use PCR and we use that to amplify it. So here we go. The mode of amplification is slightly different here, because as you can see here, so this is the two adapter sequence, and this is the oligo. Adapter will go and attach with the oligo because they are complementary in nature. Once they are attached with there, and barcode is present in the outer set. So by this way, they will use now this unknown DNA, the DNA to be sequenced, and they will produce the opponent strand using this as a template. So as you can see here, they produce the strand. Similar way, they will produce all the DNA strands by using the unknown DNA to be sequenced as a template. So what we can produce is exact replica of all those sequences. So we have all of them are produced. Some of them are now, those which are not bound are washed away. And then what we'll do, we use all those bead containing our gene to be sequenced and put it into the wells or the machines, the slides, and we add them onto the slides. So let's put them into the slides. So once you put them into the slides, then what we need to do, let's say we take this one and we need to synthesize. So here we go. This is the diameter that is mentioned. You don't need to worry about. So now how exactly the sequencing is going on here. So this is how it works. This is the strand which is to be synthesized, sequenced. This strand is to be sequenced, right? Remember, this one is to be sequenced, and this is the primer that is added. We added the primer during the amplification process. So 3' hydroxyl is free. We can polymerize this strand using simple DNTP attachment. During the addition of those DNTPs, we add fluorescently leveled DNTPs so that we get the fluorescence out of it, and our detector can detect those fluorescence and can give us a peak. Now it depends on the number of nucleotides that is present, the peak height, and also the intensity goes up and down accordingly. So let's do it. So let's say here we add only T's to check, because in all this type of next generation sequencing we use it independently, individually. We add first T, then we add A, then C, then G, singly, not all of them together, because if we add all of them together it will be very hard for us to monitor. So we add only thymines there. Then what we can see, this is the graph. And in the graph, we can see the presence of any fluorescence as a peak. So let's say here we add only T's. As you can see here, there is a C afterward at the beginning. So the complementary of C should be G. So T will not bind with it. It will be washed away. Nothing will be found. Right? Then let's say we add A. Right? So A will not again bind with C. So it will be washed away. Then what we'll add, we add G. G will bind with C because they are complementary in nature. So G will bind with C, and there is only one C. So G will bind with C and polymerization will take place. And what we'll see a peak for the G. As you can see, these are the ground peaks, right? But here comes the actual presence of G. So as the G is present, we have a fluorescent peak, right? This is telling us that there is a G right after the first primer associated template. Let's wash it away and add, let's say there's any problem, I believe. One minute. Okay, so now let's put it away and add some other nucleotide. Let's say we add again T. Now, right after C, there was an A. So if there is an A, T will pair with it. So we'll again receive another signal for that, and we get another signal. Now let's remove T and add something else. Let's add C. So now C will pair with G, and again we get another signal there. Now let's place something else. Let's say A. A will not bind, so it will be released as it is. Then let's play T. Both the T's are bound, so we get a huge peak for that. So if there is two T's, so we get the peak equivalent to the presence of twice, right? Let me take a color first here. 1 minute. Okay. 1 minute. So as there are two T's now bound with it, we get the response of T twice. So it is telling us that there are two T's present. Let's put the G here. So 3 G's, we get more higher peaks, so we get the peak equivalent to the presence of 3 nucleotides there. So this is the way we actually detect the presence of nucleotide sequence. So you can see the detection is kind of this GTC T. So it will be like this. Let's solve it. Say it is GTC TT GGG, right? So as you can see here, this is the structure that we find here. So if we know this, the structure of adding nucleotides GTC TT GGG, the opponent of it are CAGAACCC, right? So this is a kind of actual view of how the data looks like for 454 machine. And this is the ion torrent sequencing wells. This is the micro machine wells where we need to put all those beads there, and then the ion sensors are there, and all this process works. So that's how the process of next generation sequencing works, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you.